flatten ears to ground, curve shoulder into the hollow of bones of earth beneath you.
Mark, who's the second person you'd love to spend an hour with?
The second person I'm going for is Bob Monkhouse.
Yes.
Yes, I'm sure all your Australian listeners are...
Look, for those who don't... Of course, I know who you're talking about, but for those who don't, who is Bob Monkhouse?
Again, he's a bit of a weird choice. So, when I was a kid, Bob Monkhouse was a game show host. So all the old game shows, he was like one of the main hosts, very, very famous in the UK. But when I was a kid, I didn't know he was a stand-up comedian. I didn't understand all that sort of stuff. And I only found out really about him being a stand-up comedian since I started stand-up, which is also after, again, it's another dead person. He's not around anymore. So I never actually got to see him or work with him or anything like that. But he was sort of known as that old generation of comic who used to write his own stuff. So a lot of the comics back then, it was all that kind of, they'd all meet up before the shows and go, right, which joke are you doing? Which ones are, and try to work out, they all share jokes. And I just hate all that. And I quite like that he was, I imagine he probably still did do some of the older jokes as well, but he was definitely known for writing really good one-liners, and one-liners is what I do. So one, I'd love to pick his brain about just joke writing. Like he had a massive joke book that he would just write or have all his notes in. It got stolen and it was like front page news, like for ages. And they eventually found it, but that's always sort of stuck in my head that he had this joke book with all like all notes and things, and they'd work on this and then a note on that. And apparently they asked that they do, but these joke books do still exist somewhere, I think. But yeah, I just like to just, and also because my podcast is about jokes, I basically chat to other comics about jokes that they can't get to work. And then we kind of try and work out why that is, and like the difference in wording and rhythm and all that sort of stuff. And I just love talking about the structure of jokes. And I just think he'd be literally the perfect person to have had on the podcast. I'd have a lot of fun talking to him.
So you would spend your hour with Bob Monkhouse with him being a guest on your podcast? That's how you'd want to?
Another one.
Yeah.
Kind okay. of selfish in this situation to get more views on my podcast.
Yeah. On a personal level, what would you want to come away from that hour with?
That's a good question. I don't know. I think there's just being in the presence of like a legend. I think you just, there's just, I don't know. I just think I would just gain a lot of knowledge from him. I think that's, I don't really know much about him. A friend of mine actually used to be friends with him, and they used to sort of, they used to holiday together in Barbados or something. He used to love Barbados. But apparently he's a really nice bloke. But yeah, I don't know really. What would I gain from it? Just have a nice chat.
What audio have you chosen to go with Bob Monkhouse?
This is Send in the Clowns by Frank Sinatra. And you might think that that's linked to being a comedian, sort of, but it isn't directly linked. So in the film Joker, have you seen the film Joker with Joaquin Phoenix? Yeah. In that film, the Joker tries stand-up comedy. And they've stolen one of Bob Monkhouse's jokes for him to do in that film. And it's one of my favourite jokes because I think it's so perfectly written and crafted. And what I find really annoying about it is they sell it in the film like it's a bad joke. So he tells this joke, and the point of the joke is that everyone goes, that's not funny, and he's sort of dying on stage. But it's a very good joke. And Bob Monkhouse did it on TV, and it always worked. So that always really annoys me. Why didn't they just pick a bad joke for him to do? So that's the link. So the link is that this song is in that film. like the song in the film that's most famous, the scene where he's dancing down the stairs. I remembered that scene, so I wanted that song. And when I looked up, it's by Gary Glitter. I don't know if you're aware of Gary Glitter, but he's a convicted paedophile. So I've opted for Frank Sinatra instead. I also think that's a very weird choice of song in the film. Do you think the filmmakers didn't know who that was? Does it add to the film because this guy's a lunatic?
Yeah, I reckon. I tend to think people in media, especially at that level, know exactly what they're doing.
Anne stole Bob Monkhouse's joke. Other than that, it's a great film.
Yeah. So that's, you mentioned when you were talking about Pat Morita, you mentioned how the Karate Kid TV series took the baddie and looked at maybe what was behind them, which, and I was thinking as you were saying that, that's what they did with the Joker. So is there something in that for you, a connection there?
I think, well, as far as like in films and things, I just think like filmmaking is better now. So they do always go into the background of characters a bit more. Like people aren't just evil. Like even in Endgame, the Marvel film, like Endgame, the main bad guy, Thanos, they showed the reason why he thinks he's... Because bad people don't think they're bad, do they? They think they're doing the right thing. So you get to see their angle. I think that's... I just think filmmaking's a lot better now. But you're right, there is a link there. But that is why I like the Cobra Kai series so much. And also, it's the only way you can make a film about the Joker work, really, without there being a good guy in it. I think you can't just have someone being bad. And that film is relatable because of the whole him going on stage and struggling. And then that does make you go a bit mad. Mm. Not as extreme as he goes, but there is something that I can relate to that.
Yeah.
Because all those, like in the early days, just doing open mic gigs, and you'd have a bad one. And then I can vividly just see myself just on the train on the way home, just looking in the reflection in the mirror.
Yeah.
In the window, just going, what the hell are you doing with your life? And then you'd have a really good gig the next time. And all of a sudden you're king of the world. I should be on telly. It's nuts. But since I've got to a point where I know I can do the job, I know I'm good at this. When I have a bad gig, I don't have that at all now, because there are other reasons. It could just be an audience just don't like one-liners, and I do one-liners. So, you know, it is what it is. Because people always say you can't blame an audience, but my thought is you can blame an audience. Like, I think it's their fault because they don't like what I do, and it's my fault because I don't do what they like. So it's just one of those things, I think.
Yeah.
But the better you get, the less of those gigs you have, I think, because you learn how to adapt and how to make things work.
This is a song about a couple of adult people who have spent, quite a long time together, till one day one of them gets restless and decides to leave. Whether it's the man or woman who left is unimportant. It's a breakup. And it's a lovely marriage of words and music, written by Stephen Sondheim. Isn't it rich? Are we a pair? Me here at last on the ground, and you in midair. Send in the clowns. Isn't it bliss? Don't you approve? One who keeps tearing around, and one who can't move. But where are the clowns?
send in the clowns. Just when I stopped opening doors, finally finding the one that I wanted was yours. Making my entrance again with my usual flair, sure of my lines. Nobody's there. Don't you love the farce? My fault, I fear. I thought that you'd want what I want. Sorry, my dear. But where are the clowns? Send in the clowns. Don't bother, they're here. Isn't it rich? Isn't it queer? Losing my timing this late in my career. The clowns, send in the clowns. Well, maybe next year.